I've got the nut. Hi,
Connie. It's 6:30 one morning, eating a breakfast. And at 10 o'clock at night, somebody else at the same age, so just a young man, about Brian's age.
Serving?
Yeah, waiter. Still there.
My gosh.
Been there all day, and it was 10 o'clock at night. No, we want to get a picture of you chopping. Amber Bamber.
He wouldn't do that, would he?
So Sandra, pull up a chair. Somebody pull her a chair.
No.
We'll get her a chair. She can't carry it.
Carol, bring a chair right here.
We need John a chair, too, don't we?
Dad has that fried egg.
It's good. What is that on?
Sausage, fried, deep fried.
Yeah, kid.
We're going to meet the maker if you don't turn that off.
It was a nice
good Lord.
I'm putting those little smokies and you make it butter.
I want to see this. You're going to
watch me and make her. Yep. John. Everybody show him seafood.
Hey, Sandra, show us your scar.
You think I won't?
Y'all talking about me? Connie, we've had enough of that parading around, snapping a pink.
Carol Jean. Carol Jean. Come
here, I want Mike to take a picture of you so I can put it on my mirror. Because the ladies have already forgotten what you look like.
Oh.
You
got John
in
the picture. Do you want to take another angle?
I don't want John in the picture about nothing.
When do we
watch
this movie?
I made my dad breakfast in bed.
Right, yeah, they're taking a picture.
It's not doing anything.
No, I can't do it. Maybe I need my bag.
Okay, y'all.
Fine.
Look up here.
You broke the camera.
You don't need any batteries, you think?
I don't yet to make pretty
time. I can't believe it.
That was Cancun. Beautiful.
Beautiful.
Cool.
Oh, yeah. A couple hundred degrees.
Now get all free.
Connie, do you want me to take a picture?
Yeah, I remember when they were babies and... Noah.
Oh, I remember when Noah was born that the doctor said when he got Sheila's stomach open that his little head popped right out. And I remember Mike and I went to look for him some clothes to wear home. And remember we got about 6 months clothes. Yeah. 3 months clothes. Yeah. Little green, little shirt, and pants.
He's still wearing them.
It was so cute. You were just the cutest little baby. We all cried.
This picture up here. He was big. He was nine.
He was just turkey. Whoa.
Half grown.
I remember when they stamped his, I don't remember this, but I heard the story that they stamped his feet black and you thought he was a black baby.
I did. She was drugged up.
She was drugged up.
I did.
All I could see was his feet and I was like,
she said, horrible.
Main things. I don't about a year and a half. We used to join the park a lot, and we'd put off eating a little too long, and he got wanting to eat, didn't he? Wanted to eat real bad. That was cute. Angela.
Yeah, but he said, I want to eat, eat.
I want to eat, eat, yeah. And boy, we couldn't find a restaurant if we was going to be shot. Now, we was looking hard because that little boy was crying and wanting something to eat. Finally, we found a restaurant. And it wasn't too awful good, but it was something to eat.
And then we finished eating, he said, I finished.
And he thinks you ought to get up when he's finished and get the rest of it, you know.
But Daddy scolded Mama. He said, now, y'all need to have some food in this car for that baby. Yeah. No, it's not going to happen again.
But Angela has done so many cute things and all, but one of the things that stands out in my mind, you know, she always, now, Bill Burton, something about him, I don't know, she didn't much want much to do with Bill in the early days, and he's a good old man, but I guess just something about the nature. But anyhow, she always would let me take her, you know, pet her and all. But she got to doing my hair. You can see her over there putting them rollers and things in. And then when she got through, she put her hand on her face and said, my dear old grandpa. I thought that was so cute.
She got to put those clips in his hair. I thought, this child's going to get by murder. We don't want her here. Nobody put clips in his hair.
And then, as you can see in that picture, she gave me a big old kiss. That's one of my favorite pictures. That and Noah and Brian around in the hall. I don't know if y'all noticed that one or not, but I think Noah was about a year and a half. Then pretty close to the age, this picture over here to the left. And then Brian is probably 8 or so. That's one of my favorite pictures, too.
This picture on the end of Noah was taken down at the lake, and they was pulling down a big old houseboat there, and everybody was down there in the sand, and he had a good time in that sand.
Oh, yeah.
He was having fun.
Head to toe.
But another thing, both of them was good babies. They was easy to keep and didn't give you no troubles. You know, they just good kids.
As long as they fed you, right?
Yeah.
David, you got anything to say?
Nothing I can share.
Oh. Well, I can't. My memory's not that good. Never has been.
Never has been, really.
It's getting worse all the time. But the thing that always stood out with me with Noah was his little voice when he was little. He had the sweetest little voice.
Kind of like Connie's.
This precious little voice. And he was at our house in Texas one time. That's part of the reason I don't have a lot of memories, because I was in Texas so many years. But when your mama had to give you some medicine while you were at the house, boy, you had a fit. You did not want that medicine. You remember what we went through trying to get?
Yeah.
And he had fever and everything. But he's always been pretty strong-willed like his mama.
Most of the time we spend saying, Brian, get out of the front of the camera! Brian, get out!
I say it, ain't it?
You remember that time we got a chap that said which way did they go?
And it had bills everywhere.
Yeah, it had two bills.
Well, we know y'all hate this, but when you have children, you'll understand why these movies are so
You'll understand it better by and by.
Yeah.
We
talk about that.
We had just got married, and Noah spent the night with us one night, and we were renting this house in Broken Arrow.
He never spent the night again.
Anyway, for some reason, I didn't get the grass mowed quick enough for the landlord, so his name was Lewis Logan.
Oh, yeah.
And he was coming out, and he was mowing the grass, and Noah goes to the front door, "What's he doing?" I said, "That's Lewis Logan. He's going to mow our lawn." And that's a lot of L's for Noah.
Yeah.
He had troubles with his S, so he said, "That's Lewis Logan. He's going to go our yawn."
He said it all day long. "There's Lewis Logan.
Who said that?"
I'm getting way tired.
Hey, Noah, they don't have to go back so far, do they?
I think it was seeing David in his towel.
Without the towel.
Oh, God.
Well,
I remember babysitting that one when he was real little.
Yeah. And he loved that. Remember that German Shepherd that Philip had out in the backyard?
Yeah.
He would go back there. He wanted to see that dog all the time. And then my dad had those little Avon cars that he collected them. And he wanted to play with those glass. And my mom would not let anyone play with those cars. But she let Noah play. And we ate tuna fish every day.
Oh, that David loves tuna.
We could get 16 tuna fish. So we ate
y'all talking hot.
Poor Noah, I feel sorry for him. Yeah, hot. The stove was hot.
And he loved when Philip played the guitar.
Yeah, and he loved that big German Shepherd dog. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Not Noah, it's
yet
a dog.
Ryan had a dog too, didn't he?
Yeah, buddy.
John Oliver Eaters.
Yeah. That dog got into all kinds of trouble. In fact, why can't we get rid of the dog? Remember that, Mike? We told Brian that ran off and got married. We put an ad in the paper. I took Brian somewhere and you let the people come over and get the dog that day. When we first got that dog, we put that little collar on it, and it grew to about five times that big and never undid the collar. One of my little ladies said, "Something's running from that little dog's neck." Neck was that big, and collar was that big. Basset hound, and John finally went out there and put Sam on it, I think.
Didn't take the collar off.
Didn't take the collar off, just put Sam on it. No, we took the collar off.
Sorry, John.
But Angie had a rabbit, and then
and
a cat.
Yeah, and when I found
Brian
dead,
then.
Brian was there.
Yeah.
Because I went to go feed it, and I was like, "Daddy, is it supposed to lay like that?" I know, and it was like laying up straight, and Brian comes up, picks it up by the tails, and goes, and steps in the board and goes, "Yup, it's dead."
Freaking out. Out. After college, oh, you got that kitty cat, remember?
And I didn't get birth with a cat.
We couldn't replace Brian with a cat.
Well,
that
cat.
Was shock when Connie liked that cat. Well, I had to, because Angel.
I want a cat.
She won't let me get a pet goat.
Got Connie.
Yeah, why do you need that mess, isn't that?
She's got your goat, right?
Isn't that smart?
What have you done, Hucky boy? I got that.
Don't talk like that.
I appreciate Angie kind of showing the ropes to the girls when we first moved back and kind of taking them under her wing at church and at times at home and being the example that you were to them at the time when they really needed it.
I wish I had a mirror so I could show you too.
But now, y'all getting ready to move into a serious state of life now, you know that. Whether you go to higher school for higher education or whether you make plans for jobs or I won't be too terribly far out in the future. Be thinking about marriage and
Yeah, you can quit talking about that.
Yeah, you can quit talking about it, but it's going to happen. Unless they're funny. It's a good world if you make it that, you know. Good life if you make it that way, but you need to plan every day as you go along. Get ready for a good future. One thing we can be thankful for, we live in a great country. You know, John and Connie just came back from Mexico, and people down there are so poor. And not only there, but a lot of other places in the world, they don't know how they're going to eat the next meal. A lot of people over in Bosnia hadn't eaten a week. Now, you talk about being hungry and starving if you miss a meal or two. You know, suppose you hadn't eaten in a week. Didn't have a bed to lay down on or any running water or nothing. And a lot of them even driven out of the country on the road and don't know what they're going to do. Thousands of them. So we got a good country here, wonderful country, and a good Lord, you know. And I think you too will make the best of it, make a good choice.
Good family.
Yeah.
Don't ever take for granted that you have a family that loves you and grandparents that paved the way.
See it here.
I love those colors.
I mean, you did good.
That's beautiful, Thelma.
What a wonderful memory.
Yes.
I really like that. I'll tell you, that's a view.
Those are pretty colors.
I know, they're gorgeous.
Through this window.
They look like my thank you notes, y'all. We didn't
look at the back of it, Angie.
Oh, it's the
back. Boy, let's... You
can see all the stitches in
there. You go.
You two can keep warm, that's for sure.
Yeah. That could be your college blanket.
Yes.
I like it. It looks like it's kind of lightweight. Not real heavy.
Thelma, did you make the one Brian took down there, that green one?
Yes.
What you did.
Yeah, thank you.
Let me see your baby doll then. Open up your envelopes. Down.
You know those sell around 350, 400 now.
Do they?
Yeah.
No, I'm just in the back of the street.
David a hug. Wish I had a mirror to show your jagged tooth. John has no tooth because he's a hillbilly. He has an IQ of 3.
Right now, I mean.
You show mirror
that.
Hey, John. John, is that? You sometimes put a straw in that hole where your tooth goes.
John, just get right over in front of it. Smile.
Amber, I can't believe you said it.
John,
he's just shining his tooth at us. His toothless at us.
Isn't that kind? Fine peoples.
What a doll. He said, still hold the straw.
When do we get the speeches from the graduates?
After 20 years.
I remember when Angie first started driving, she didn't come to the right restaurant to meet us. Well, no, that was last week.
Yeah.
Oh.
Remember Angie tried to kill us getting out of the North Carolina.
I remember that. We were on two wheels turning around.
What happened?
I've seen that in the corner.
Oh, that was just the other day, too.
Oh, wait, I remember when Grandma and Grandpa said, I remember when y'all switched country clubs and I never knew.
Yeah, you remember that, don't you, babe?
I remember that.
You sit the day at Meadowbrook and we were.
Yeah, friends.
Like, oh, yeah. Daniel had a funny story you could tell about it.
Daniel, remember?
I didn't do it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Angie made a promise she would never tell, and he never did.
Oh, the only secret he's ever kept.
The only secret he's ever kept.
You should be proud.
I told you a promise. What?
A long time ago, you told me some secret.
About kissing some little boy.
Oh, you told
me. Oh! Uh-oh! We want to hear it.
She was about 13, but
she said not to tell John because she'd get mad. And so they said, I promise I won't tell. So John comes walking back to the car and goes, Angie.
I saw what we were talking about.
Oh, John!
And he was like, Jake didn't say anything about it.
I was mad. My 5th-grade boyfriend. He kissed me on the cheek.
And she said, don't tell him. I promise. She started almost crying.
I'll get in trouble.
It was great.
So John comes around and Daniel goes.
I was 7 or 8.
Yeah, way to hang it over my head, thanks.
Well, we got that out on the open and on videotape.
Got it out on videotape.
Good promise keeper, huh?
Hey, it's been kept for 6 or 7 years.
Statute of limitations.
Yeah. After 5 years, you can go ahead.
Thank you, David and Sam.
You're welcome.
Thank you a lot.
Blame it on me, you're bad tooth.
I don't have a bad tooth. We have a dental plan.
We have a dental
plan. John said instead of having a dental plan, I think I'll just take that ring.
I've still got a headache from where he jabbed something plumb up into my eye socket.
That's why you want to go back.
Angie, I heard that.
You have to have a brain to
have. What'd you say, Mike?
Well, so is Noah giving his speech first or Angie?
Angie.
Oh, yeah, ladies first.
Maybe or for something else.
My God.
Quiet.
First, goodness, I'm gonna cry. Are you sorry?
It runs the family, honey.
Yeah.
We were blessed with big tear ducts.
You know, we've been talking about Angie and Noah quite a bit. See them pictures up above that?
Yeah. You'll never know.
I'm sitting right here.
She can't hear that.
She told your father, like, you've been mean.
She wants to keep all her teeth.
Oh, my
God. And try to keep all your teeth.
Yes, I will. And if I do lose them, I'll wear what the dentist gives me. Yeah. I want one.
Carol, are you crying too?
Oh, you know it.
But I know senior year is supposed to be the time of your life and supposed to be, you know, just, I mean, this is it. Nothing will compare to your senior year. And I have had the time of my life, but I know that God has shown me so much this year. And I know that He has really stretched me to my limit with friends and with just different things. But I know you always hear people, anytime you step into a church, you always hear people say, you know, God's faithful and God will always bring you through and God's always right there. And those are just easy words to pass in and out of your ears. But, I mean, He has just shown me time and again this year how faithful He is to me and how all He wants to do is love on me. And He created me the way He wanted me. And if I can say anything to any of you girls or Noah or Daniel or any of you, is that God made you exactly the way He wanted you. And He wouldn't have made you unless He loved you and unless He wanted to be with you. And when He couldn't be with you, He sent His Son to die for you. And to me, that is amazing. And that makes me want to do nothing but glorify God in my life, because He loved me so much and He wanted to be with me so much that He sent His Son to die for me. And this is really, I know it sounds cheesy, but I mean, that's just a lot of what He showed me this year. And you can hear that in VBS until you're blue in the face, but unless it really hits home, it'll never mean anything. And so I know that God loves me, and I know He's got a plan for my life, and I know that if I don't know it right now, or I don't know where I'm headed, or whatnot, that He's never going to let me fall, because I'm His own. And I know that my dad would never do anything that wasn't in my best interest, or that he didn't, or, you know, so how much more is God going to do for me? Anyways, that's like 5.7 for y'all. Okay, then it's 4.7. But it'll be on tape next Sunday. But I love y'all, and I thank you for always being there and for being the wonderful family that you are.
Me too. I just want to thank all of y'all. She was saying that your senior year is supposed to be the highlight of your life. If that's the case, I mean, for a world that hurt. This has been my roughest year, I think, out of all my years. Especially financially, with, you know, I've got the car that every kid in the high school wants, but it's, you know, draining me of everything. Thank both of y'all for sticking with it. Thank you. Grandma and Grandpa. It's just, whenever you're younger, you think you can't wait till you're going to be a senior. And every one of us. It's not like, you know, they're behind me, but they're not behind you all. It's everyone is behind everybody.
Yeah.
Like she was saying, there's, you know, you go to school and you talk to, you know, one class of 30 people and 27 people don't even have their original parents. You know, or they don't even have parents. They're living by themselves. Used to be when you all were kids is that the minority was people who didn't have a dad or a mom. Now it's the minority is, you know, I can't believe you're
I think you're right, Noah. Just in by Noah.
But I'm so glad that I'm so glad I'm fixed to be out of school, because, and I don't want to have kids. I don't want to, because.
Ever?
Because the way people's children are now, I don't want my kids going to school with these people. I don't want my kids going to school wearing, you know, going through metal detectors. That, you know, I remember when I was growing up, they talked about in Chicago and stuff, the metal detectors in the bar on the windows. Well, right now, Broken Arrow's, like, proposing a plan for metal detectors. This is a little sub-community of Tulsa, of Oklahoma, a little hick town, and we're getting metal detectors. We're the number one right now for the next, Broken Arrow High School is the number one school out of all the schools in the United States for something like that to happen again.
Your
been
kid.
On the news, been in magazines.
I've never heard that. That's terrible.
This week.
Wow.
But I also heard on the news that Broken Arrow is close to being number three in the state.
Yeah.
I even went by a law, and it's a pretty good size anymore.
It's just, I mean, I remember when I was younger and I was looking at the kids that were older in high school, and I thought because, you know, they did spiked up hair, they were, you know, they were bad. Now there's kids that are half of my age that are killing people for no reason. And I just, you know, in the Bible it says that it's, everything's just going to start going downhill. And that's when you know it's going to happen. And, I mean, I feel like, you know, in 5 minutes, he could be headed this way.
Yeah.
So it's just,
right.
I mean, you just look at it and look at the way it is today. It just, it's scary to think that. Everything is exactly lined up. We're just waiting. We're just waiting on you. So, I just thank all of y'all, though, for helping everybody and staying together as a family. That's it.
You know, I was going to grade school out of Evans. It was one school. 8 grades in one building, you know. Then it was paper, I call them spitballs, and yeah. Chewing gum then, you know, was what the big deal was. You know, you couldn't chew gum, you couldn't throw spitballs and stuff like that, but how it has grown out of proportion,
well, I want to say that Aunt O'Brien would love to tell you that you're just the best little sister, and he's very proud of you. But I remember when John and I was trying to have you so bad, we couldn't have a baby. And then when you were born and you were the little girl I always wanted, and then you let me fix you up, you know, on the outside. But I thank God for your influences of grandmas and grandpas. You had two of the best sets in the world. Grandma Ruby and Grandpa Bill would be so proud of you. And I want to thank you for listening and being obedient as a child. And because of that, I think it helps you and you all the way up. Obedience is a wonderful thing. And it honors God and honors your parents. And I'm just so grateful that you've turned into such a sweet little young lady. And Noah, you're just a precious young man.
I thought you were going to call him a young lady.
No. And I just thank God, Noah. You just got a heart for God. You guys are just precious teenage kids that are going to make a change in the adult world. And that's what needs to happen.
No, I love you and I'm proud of you. You've done things in the church. You've taken on ministries that adults wouldn't take. And you've done, you know, even out in the work, you feel you've always done a great job. But more than anything is you. I loved how you respect and loved your dad. And he didn't have that with his dad until he was much older. And I know you know it, but you're very lucky to have a daddy. I had a daddy that loved me and always was behind me all the time. But not everybody's that fortunate. And you've got a sister that loves you. I know you all don't always see eye to eye.
But you know, she'd give you everything she had. And I would too. And I'm proud of the way that you have, like I said, been obedient. You've not always agreed with what we've asked you to do or told you to do, but you've done it out of respect. You know, and your dad and I, it's not easy staying married for 22 years. But if I left him, then he'd be happy. And I can't have that. You know, and I had a mom, you know, my mama loved me and was always, you know, she always took care of everything. You know, she always had everything I always wanted. There was always quick chocolate milk mix in the cabinet for me. And there was always, and I drank out of a jar, and my jar was always there. And, you know, that's the trivial things, but that's the things that are really so important, the little bitty things that... You know, I appreciate you, and I love you very much. I couldn't ask for anybody I'd rather have as my son. And Angie, I love you, and I appreciate your spiritual growth that you've had and your leadership. It's hard at your age and those ages to be as strong. It's like one of the girls, you know, that died in Colorado. She died because she said, yes, I do love Jesus. And, you know, most people, it's just easier to just be in the back and not do anything. But, you know, I know it takes extra strength, and I know you also get a lot of problems come through. But, you know, God has blessed you, and He will bless you because of your stand. And so I know if you're this strong now, you know, you'll be awesome as a Christian mother and as a wife.
Upon penalty of death.
Is this close to being free? No.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Mike.
I don't know what to say except that I'm very proud of both of you guys. For the Christian walk that y'all have both had at your age, I think by the time you're our age, which I know now looks real old, it'll come up on you quick. And I hope y'all continue to. It's youth like you guys going to being adults that are the only thing that we have to look forward to as old people. Somebody like you guys being in charge. I'm just real proud of both of you.
Johnny, you have anything to say?
You
hold the camera? Yeah,
please hold the camera. Let me hold the
camera. David, take the camera from him and let him talk a minute.
Are we going to run out of film? It's like running.
Yeah. Talk, John. Say what you feel today.
I just don't know what to say.
We'll start talking.
Everybody makes fun of me all the time.
It's not about you, John.
John, it's about the children today. It's about Noah and Angie.
I remember when we had Brian for years, he was the only grandson. Is it 8 or 10 years, wasn't it?
7
How old
years.
Is he?
7 years
seven?
Before Noah came.
Yeah, he's 7 years older than Noah.
And we, Connie and I tried for maybe 2 solid years to have another child, and went to the doctor, and he told us we couldn't have kids, and we said we already had one. And he said, oh, well, maybe there's a problem, you know, so.
Oh, well.
But there was a fine lady that kind of did her hair. Her name was Faye Weaver, and she was a fine Christian. And she was one of the strongest Christian ladies I'd ever met. And she, when she prayed, she moved mountains. You could ask her to pray for something, and it would happen. And... Connie gave her frustrations about not being able to get pregnant. And Faye told her that until she gave it to God, that it was just going to be something that she and I was working on, and that we had to give it to the Lord. And I don't really remember when Connie gave it up to the Lord. I wanted another child, but I think it didn't press me as hard as it pressed her.
She gave it up. And she told Faye. And Faye, I think it was a couple of weeks later, told Connie that she was going to the hospital. And she said, Connie, I'm not coming out. She said, the Lord told me that I wasn't gonna go through this. I was going to heaven. And she had a tumor in her head, and it was a brain cancer. And sure enough, she died in the hospital that week. But she told Connie when she left that day that God was going to give her that little girl. You remember that?
Mm-hmm. The day I went to her funeral, I found out I was pregnant with Angie.
And I just, you know, to have a daughter that's everything you would want her to be. There's not one thing I could add to you. And I just love you so much. Give my life. Noah, I know you're special to your mom and dad. And I know you made them proud. But the next few years, you know, you plan your lives, and you stick to your plan, and stay faithful to the Lord. But I'll tell you, you see people all around you, and they're going their way, and they're doing their thing, their way. And unless you follow God and do it God's way, it can go to this array. And you stay faithful, Loa, Angie, the Lord. He said that if you would seek Him and seek first the kingdom of God, all these other things will be added unto you. That's so simple. That's so simple, that plan. And you do that, I think your life will be rich and full.
You do too.
It's the key.
What we're talking about now are pretty, or handsome and smart, you know, they're all intelligent, they're all good looking kids, and that's wonderful. But the greatest thing of all, far as I know at least, every one of you are Christians. That's worth more to me than anything you could do. There's nothing like loving the Lord. Nothing like being a Christian. Not only to die by, but you can go through life with a lot happier life and a lot more respective life. And, you know, life is more worth living when your conscience are clear and you're trying to do what the Lord wants. And I'm so proud of y'all, you know, for accepting Christ as your Savior. Never be ashamed of Him, because in Him we live, move, and have our being. We are to be glad to have the opportunity to speak for a Lord that was innocent, wonderful, and yet suffered a horrible death for you and I. He's wonderful, and we want to always be proud of the Lord. I'm proud of you too. Proud of these others that's coming along. You know, Brian, he done graduated years back, and couple years, Lynn's in about three, I guess, Amber, so it ain't gonna be long. At least. And then about four, another one over here, so.
Allison, what, two, three?
Grandpa don't have no babies anymore, but he has some wonderful grandkids.
You got David. He's a big baby.
Yeah, I always have David.
And Noah, you were talking about not having children, and I can certainly understand with the times as they are. How you feel that way and why you feel that way. One thing each of us adults could tell you, we all have had our share of heartache and adversity in our lives. And the great James Dobson, who John kind of turned me on to, wrote a book called How to Deal with Adversity. And Angie knows from this last senior year especially, and I know you probably have too, that whether you're young or you're old, you're going to deal with adversity in your life. You're going to deal with heartache and sadness. And there are things and consequences in life that you won't be able to control. You have a choice of the mate that you pick, which you always want to be, leave that in God's hands. You have a choice of putting it in God's hands before you make any decision. But there are some things in life that happen that you have no control over. Going to break your heart, that's going to disappoint you, that is going to be adverse to what you had planned. But again, if you've got God on your side, I've had people tell me that I could couldn't, there's no way I could raise two children and they could come out right and as a single parent, as a single mother. And I don't know how right they are, but I feel like they're pretty right. I feel like we've done pretty good, but they've helped me. They've helped me by staying close to God and obeying me too.
Right, pretty right.
So it's anything can be done.
You missed it all.
Have God. What about Bruce? Hey, Bruce got plenty to say.
Hey, it's my turn. I'm going to try to
do it. Okay, let's go.
I'm going to try not to cry.
Okay,
never mind.
Go ahead.
I got it on tape, though. You're going to again.
Yes, I take this open mic floor. I know a lot of what I've said is cliched, and we've all heard already ministers talk about it, but or pastors or whatever. But I think one of the things that God showed me this year is that it's really all about Him, and it's not about me, and it's all about His plan, and it's all about His will, and that. No matter how much I kick and scream and complain, He's not going to change His mind, because it's what He wants for me, and it's His best. And even though I can't see it with my eyes, and I can't see that far ahead, that I know that it's in His best interest, and that there's a fine line between being in the world and of the world, and that's just one of the hardest things, and it's so easy to get caught up in. But I know that it's not about me. It's not about what I want. And it's not about me being in the center of attention. It's not about me being in the spotlight. It's not about me getting what I want. It's about, you know, God and my life glorifying Him. And that sounds really cliche, and it's easy to say and really hard to do. I still don't want to do it, but
David, you have last chance here.
David hadn't said a word.
Yeah, David's talked. I got it on tape.
We know he can talk.
Kind of depressing, but I got it.
Used to.
Got stars to prove it.
That's why I have beard today.
We
to
have
cover the scars.
We have the frogging video at home.
I was born a poor black child.
And